What's up, y'all? Welcome, welcome, welcome. It's the 283rd day of Make It Songbringer. Yippee-yay. Man, I'm really stoked, actually, because the lights, everything is working so well. Arcane, Boogie, Jules, J2, what's up, y'all? Hey, guys. So, yeah, last night I was refining the area transitions. Things are a lot better. The shadows used to grow in kind of weird. What's up, PETA? Melazio. Now the shadows are really, really accurate, so. This stream is in Polish. Right? I think what's up, hey, Rocket Bunny? I think that was a, yeah, sometimes I put the word polish. Right on. So, yeah, check it out. The shadows. You can see them moving. So right now it's a 10-minute clock. Every 10 minutes it goes through a whole day-night cycle. So the shadows are right now, they're just going away. Pretty soon it'll be nighttime. Sweet. Nice. What's up, Brandon Dyer? Yeah, the day-night cycle. Man, this has got me really stoked, too. I'm so glad this turned out so well. It took, you know, several days to get this all dialed in just for the shader. But now that all that's done, this whole day-night cycle is really cool. It's going to be really fun. What's up, JFK? Yeah, you can see it's already getting to be nighttime in the game right now. Oh, can you hear the sound? Hold on a second. Yeah, so for some reason it always goes to Soundflower. I just love Soundflower. I don't know why. So it didn't save my time. You know, when you exit out of the game or whatever, it... Whoops. Let me show you what I mean. So it runs the game's clock, or the daylight clock. Why aren't there shadows at nighttime? Stayed Up Games, what's up? Artemis, what's up? Why aren't there shadows at night? Because there's no moon. Yeah, I just wanted to have it to be distinct. So there are shadows. You can see if there's light, like from these, for example, from these pillars here. They emit shadows. But here, yeah, I turned off shadows completely at night to make it more distinct, to make it more like, you know, like it's really obvious that was daylight and this is the night. So, I mean, it's really easy if I want to go put shadows in for nighttime as well. But I just got the cycle working that way and I just decided to leave it. So let me show you this. This is really cool. If I go from one area to another, like let's go back in time to like there. So we're at daytime. And then put the player at the beginning. What's up, Zakma? Twitch crashed. The shadows from Jib's light? Check this out, though. It used to really be really horrible when you'd go from one area to another. The shadows would shrink. And then they would grow back in, so it was really unnatural. Now it's completely natural, so you go from one area to another, and it smoothly blends in and out shadows. So that's pretty cool. This area right here was one of the most visible ones because this has two lights right here. These two pillars generate two lights, and they're very strong. You can see the two shadows are pretty strong here, and then You go to another area, and there's no lights on this area except for the main light. So that's why you could see pretty clearly that the blending. Yeah, so let's put the time back to, I don't know, nighttime maybe. And today I'm going to be working on a bunch of polish elements. So I got to, I'm thinking that the alpha update's going to come out next week. So I was trying to have it out this month, but it's just not quite ready. But I think I can get it all finished by next week. There's these things on my list I want to get done before the alpha's out. So the rest of this week and next week, I want to be working on these little polish elements so we can get this this alpha update out. So this is like the depth of night. This is like the darkest part of night right here. You just barely have a light. Yeah, alpha update. Yeah, I can't wait to get that out. And now the light's getting stronger already. It's pretty fast because I mean it's only 10 minutes to go from, you know, an entire day lasts only 10 minutes, so. All right. So yeah, let's start on these polish elements. Oh, look at that. It's even nighttime right there. I guess I'll add that to the polish. So, my time is being applied to the main menu. Okay, so I'm gonna start off with these little items right here. On my list. One thing I want to do is make it clear that the top hat can pick up items. So we'll take away the top hat. So that the mini boss appears, which is, I think mini boss might be this one. Let's see what that old guy is. It gives you the item one. Oh yeah, that's it right there. So mini boss one, we need to take that off. Right, yeah. So really all I'm gonna do here is just make the text clear. So when you first get the top hat, it's like super clear that you can pick up items. Oh my God. I don't know. How it give it two of these bosses? Oh, that makes sense. It's the first guy. Okay. This guy. We can. It's mini boss zero that we're looking at. Mini boss one is not what we want. Mini boss zero. So back to 4-1 where we just were there. I don't know why it's giving him. What's up, Bafu? Why it's putting two of these bosses here? I didn't that time. Get you with the top hat. I already have a top hat. What's up, Scottish Pizza? All right, so yeah, if we kill this guy, we'll get the first Ban Bafu, no way, man. What's V ban? All right. Yeah, so all I want that to say there is he can pick up items. picks up items. Turns like a boomerang. Oh, you're trying to escape the slash? Oh. I thought it was a Unicode character. Right, let's check that out. That should be quick. This is a nice quick fix right here. This is just from watching my friend play. I'm like, I noticed that my friend really didn't notice that you could what you can do with the top hat with throwing the drones or whatever. Ooh, that was a nice one. I'm totally cheating right here because you're not supposed to have these items yet. Gotcha! What was Jib doing there? Throw the top hat. Picks up items. Returns like a boomerang. Good enough! My Easter egg in dedication to the greatest developer of all time. Oh, pff. Thanks, man. That's awesome. Check it out. You got that old school graphic. That's from so long ago. Okay, that's one done. Bam. The next one is that I wanted to make clear that the bomb container, right now the bomb container shows you some text for bomb containers, but the first time you get a bomb container, I wanted to say how to use bombs, not how to use the container or what the container does. So let's make it so the player does not even have bombs, and we'll go to some place where we can get bombs. Maybe the store, or maybe a level. Nice, you saved it. Right on. Cool. Is your screen saver? No way. That's great. Bomb container. So we'll take away bomb containers. Put the player where they could get the bomb container. There's one in the store. Store Z is like, what's the store Z? It's -200. I think we should be able to buy some bombs at -200. What kind of specs would you need to run Songbringer? It really doesn't take much, Red Sands. It can run on pretty old computers. It's a completely 2D game, and I've optimized it a lot, so it should be able to run on, maybe like 500 megs of RAM even, and like a really low processor, simple GPU. You shouldn't need too much. I did put some actual specs up on the Steam page. So if you want to go look for Steam, look on Steam for Songbringer, and it's got some specs there. Oh, you got Windows XP? Okay, so one thing about Windows XP is that it's supposed to run, but for some reason it doesn't run on my Windows XP test. But it might be just my computer is really, really out of date or something like that. Like I have an old Windows XP. So I'm not sure if Windows XP will run it. That's a maybe. Visual Studio is supposed to compile it so that it will run on Windows XP. And I've got the settings for Windows XP compiling and all that, but for some reason it doesn't run once I tried it on my Windows XP test system. So I can't guarantee that Windows XP is gonna run it. But I hope it will. It's supposed to. You run it on your Lotus spec potato. Yeah, it's Wasteland with an E. Cool, Wasteland Explorer. Oh, so that one, we want to be negative 201. It's other store. There we go. Okay, we can buy some bombs here. All right, let's see what they say. Yeah, so there's the problem. Basically, you get the first bomb container, and it really should show you the how to use bombs, not necessarily that you've gotten more bombs. So okay, let's make that clear. I think what we want to do is it's in Yeah, sometimes you can get away with red text if it's like light red. Or if you have a nice or really, really bright background, it's a dark red. What you're going for is contrast, tone value. And the way Scottish pizza, the way you can test for that is you can just make everything grayscale, and then you can see how much contrast there is versus your text versus your background. And that as also goes for characters in your game too. When you're drawing characters or even any kind of foreground pieces of art or whatever, you always want them to be a little bit more, a little bit, the contrast difference is a little bit different than your background, you know? So that also helps to just, turn on a grayscale shader or take a screenshot and make it grayscale so you can see. I think it's in pickup item. Like diamond bomb. Here we go. Wait, no, we want bomb container. Oh, right. We have bomb container one and then the other ones. Let's see. Strings English. Bomb container one. Let's actually go here, set a breakpoint, and see what's going on. Because really, this should be one right there. I just noticed that too. Teleport cube. Gotta decide where to put that. Right now it's for free in the store. You just pick it up. So that's a question I've got for you guys. Where do you think you should get the teleport cube? I think you should get the teleport cube after the first level. So either you get it at the end of for the level one, or you can buy it from the store, perhaps after you've gotten like 100 coins or whatever, or diamonds. Have I made a video ad of Songbringer? Yes, I've made several of them. The latest one is, I think it's Bang Trailer. There you go. Yeah, Bapu, you're so awesome. End of level one or in a store? I don't know, I'm kind of leaning towards the store. I don't know. But it is kind of really central to the plot. Or maybe a random encounter. That's a good point. Yeah, that's a total possibility. After you've gotten through level one, you could have a random encounter where you pick up the teleport cube. That's definitely worthy of considering. Let's put that on there. In a secret place lying beyond a giant monster. Cool idea too. Where did you get that awesome font? Are you talking to Scottish Pizza? All right. Count bomb containers. How many are there? One. That's what we were expecting. Good. We have one. Just Jeff. Yes, just Jeff. There's already two random encounters, two random mini bosses. The first you get your ability to throw your top hat. It happens very at the very beginning of the game. And then also a little bit past that, you get this the first compass, which guides you to level one. Those are both random encounters. But yeah, the teleport cube is a pretty central item because you have to be able to warp back to Songbringer to craft items. And it also advances the plot. A lot of the plot will be advanced on Songbringer, the ship. No, in Songbringer? What font? Oh, that's a custom font. I drew that by hand. Yeah, that's all just, you know, it's pixel art. Oops, here. Yeah, so there's the font. It was based on some other font, like I think it was called Roboto or something like that. And then I just, you know, when you make something pixel art though, it has to all change. Like this is nowhere near Roboto anymore. I think it was Roboto. I don't remember. Okay, so yeah, we should have one bomb container. We're setting the flux. What is the flux's set item already? Let's see, flux item was bomb container 10, right? And now we should be overriding that and putting it to 1. All right, good. And then we'd run this transition where we do item. And in the flux transition for item, there's this bit where it's going to get the item that we're going to show. Image, where do we get that? Oh, here is parse text key. Here. We'll run to there. Now, where is it ending? Yeah, okay. Flux item. Flux item is still bomb container 1. What does flux mean? It's just the shorter word for transition. It just means transition. These are all the kinds of, in flux.cpp, I have a whole bunch of different kinds of transitions. You know, like sliding from one area to another. Opening up the game at the very beginning. Going downstairs, going upstairs, fading in, fading out, teleporting. Closing, zooming in, walking, elevators, tons. There's tons of transitions. It helps you go back in time. It's the flux capacitor, man. All you gotta do is throw in some empty banana peels, some trash, you know, spit in there, hawk a loogie, boom, you're good to go. Go back in time. Haven't you seen Back to the Future? Boogie flux, the action or process of flowing or flowing out. Okay, this is the right item frame. This also, text should be fine. Bomb container. Maximum bomb cubes increased. That's the problem right here. Get text key. Here we go. Okay, we need another case right here. Reuse text for bomb containers, but also first bomb container is unique. First bomb container. Okay, item bomb container 1 does 1. There we go. The stream, what? The stream died? No, not again, really. It's okay on my end. Flux Cannon was a type of emplacement weapon developed by the Animid Schism Collective, the ASK, that was able to destroy capital ships with a single blast. Sounds like a Death Star. Rooney Clip, what's up, man? Do I still have a job in this? No, I do not. I do not have a job. I've been doing this full time. And yeah, you're right. The Kickstarter did only make 15K, and I'm a very frugal man, though. I'm able to live off very little. I'm alpha funding it also. So I make a little bit of dough from selling pre-orders of the game. So you can actually pre-order this game, sombrew.com, pre-order. Yep, and that's a good question, right? It's a good question. So at first I started this whole project off with no money and making no money. And I was barely making it by on a month-to-month basis by doing some web work. And then I did the Kickstarter. The Kickstarter succeeded. And now alpha funding too. So I can make it till the end of this game. And then hopefully this game does well. And I don't have to worry about cash as much in life for the next while. Still up. Good. All right, so that wasn't descriptive enough. Let's do that again. What opacity value are you using for your shades? You mean shadows? Yeah, Rooney Clip, I should set up a Patreon. People have been telling me to do that forever. I need to do that. Totally. I agree. I just got to get to freaking do it, you know? Nice. Yeah, it is like a child. Creations are like childs. I totally agree. Jules, what opacity value? The shadows are currently a little bit too soft, but the maximum is right now is 50, which is 50 out of 255, which is one fifth. About, yeah, it's about 20%. Strings English. All right, so the first bomb cube. Wait, first bomb container. Actually, yeah, let's do this one. What's up, Biwegas? Hey, dude, are you still polishing this game? Yep. Oh, sweet, man. Hey, it's been a while. Hope you're doing good. Day 90, right? Yeah, this is like almost day 290. Well, so some days I'm doing polish, right? And that's just to, I've done several releases for this game. So there was like a release around the Kickstarter time. These have all been alpha releases, right? Beta is not going to be till, when's beta? It'll be a few months from now. So yeah, that's why you see me doing polish out from time to time. Where the heck was that gear component? Yeah, so if it's bomb container one, let's just do a can of bomb. And in gear systems pickup item, we don't need to do this one. That's automatic. And then also in strings English, we no longer need this first bomb container one. Actually, let's switch that around. Let's go gear component. If it's K-Atom Bomb Container 1, we do bomb. Otherwise, we do K-Atom Bomb Container 1. There. Okay. Now let's make sure these strings are good. Bomb cube says, it explodes. What else do you want to know? It's kind of funny. Bomb container... maximum bomb cubes increased by 4. Looks good. Let's see how that looks now. Yeah, boy, I guess, yep, it's already been through green light. That was months ago. That was all the way back in May or April. And yeah, it got green lit. It's already on Steam. You can search for Songbringer on Steam. It's there. So you can wish list it, follow it, and all that. It didn't work. All right, we got to set another breakpoint and figure out why that didn't work. Here we go. Go back to flux. Oh, there you go. Thanks, Boogie. Nice. And we gotta go flux item. So that should have been a just bombs. Oh, I think it's because it might have been, it needed to be get text key. So the flux item itself, where is that? Bomb container 10. Oh, yeah. So we do need to do that twice. Back in gear system. There. So yeah, if we got less than or equal to one bomb container, the flux item we want to do is just cat and bomb. Turn off breakpoints, run that again. What's a virtual void? A virtual void, you get a void is just a function that returns nothing. Virtual is a function that can override its parent or its super class. So for example, if you have a parent class and you have a child class that derives from that parent class, usually in the child class you use virtual on most of your methods because you want them to override the parent. So you should research that on your own, because my little quick description of that is really not adequate. There we go, bomb cube. Nice. Will there be an Android, iPad, or any other platform releases? Yes, there's confirmed. There's for sure going to be iOS, and Android is a possibility, and also consoles are a possibility. I will have more info on that in the next couple months. So yeah, for sure iOS. Oh, the game audio is quiet? What's up with that? Wait, is it because I'm in this place? Like, is it still quiet? It sounds nice and loud on my headphones. Let's see. Got a game show. Oh yeah, it does look really quiet, huh? Nice, right on. Yeah, what's up with the sound today? Yeah, it's like way low. Might have been because I was using. Does that help? Probably not. Doesn't look like it is. What's it like being a full-time indie developer? Well, hell, I'll tell you what it was like at first. It sucked at first because, you know, I wasn't actually a full-time developer until, you know, I took the risk. At first, it's risky. It's hard. But then it's very rewarding. If you can actually pull it off, if you can make it happen full-time as an indie, it can be very rewarding. But it's also very stressful because until you've made money, you know what I mean? If you haven't actually made any money, it's very stressful. Unless you're, you know, living and you already have all of your expenses covered, you're living with your parents or whatever, or you have some great situation and you've already got all the money you need in the world, then you're good, man. Don't worry about that. But yeah, it's just working for yourself in general can be a stressful thing, or it can be freaking awesome. In general, you got to kind of like embrace the both aspects. You know, there's pros and cons of everything, and in this, it's so awesome being able to do whatever I want every day. That's my favorite thing about being a full-time indie developer. I love doing my own thing. I love making my own game and all that. So I don't know what's up with the sound today, guys. I don't know if I could fix this right now. Looks like we might just have horrible noise. Wait, what if I turn off? Wait, hold on. What if I just turn off the headphones? We might have bad quality audio, but at least we'll have audio, maybe. Let's run the game again. Do you get anything else for pre-ordering the game for $32.64? Yes, you do. Yeah, the $32 one, you get access to the beta. And there's a few other things. And the $64 one, you get access to the alpha, and you get your name in gold on the main menu. But in general, you can check it all out at songbrewer.com/pre-order. And it goes into detail about all that. This is what you get for $32. This is what you get for 64. Sound. Did that help? Wait. So this is probably going to be bad audio, but you might be able to hear it better now. Right, yeah, Boogie, thanks, man. Yep, alpha just totally. That's the simplest way to put it. It's the sooner version, but more bugs. Cool swordsman, Jules. Yeah, man. That's definitely cool. Right, I know. Just like old times audio. Is it too loud though? That doesn't look too loud. Yeah. It gets all crashy when it goes to the game show. But if you go full-time indie, doesn't it mean it isn't indie anymore? No, definitely not at all. Independent just means you're your own studio. You're doing your own thing. You know, when you're part of a giant team, you're like far part of some like triple A studio. This is kind of a gray area, but I think the really the difference between indies and is just indies versus triple A's, you know, big studios. Did I add some additional effects on the audio? Only baked in. I just bake in different effects and stuff like that. But no, there's not like any actual plugins or anything running on the audio. So pre-alpha is like really early development. Yes, Ragga Bunny. Pre-alpha is like prototype phase. That's like the first few months of your game's development. Alpha is like when your game is a little more mature, but it's not even anywhere near beta. Beta is where it's like ready for people to play. It's like almost complete game. And then, you know, there's also the term gold. Gold is like when you actually finally release your game. Now there's, you know, now we have the term early access as well. Thanks, Red Sands. So did that work? Yeah, bomb cube. Sorry, is that too loud? Let me know if that's too loud. Bomb cube, it explodes. What else do you want to know? That's good. Okay, let's cross that one off the list too. Triple A equals not indie. Boyes, don't I plan to join any Triple A studios? Definitely not. I've worked for companies before. I've worked for Triple A studios before, and I love doing my own thing. It means you haven't been absorbed and destroyed by EA. or Activision. Oh no, it's really loud. God damn. This is the problem with the bad audio. Sorry about that, guys. All right, I'm just going to turn it way down. Sorry about the audio today. I don't know what happened, but my computer just got screwed up. Okay, well, next thing on the list, let's get on to something else. Let's color the store stairs entrance. Fact, this one might be a good one. Yeah, this is a great one right here. We just need to make it actually daytime to be able to see this. Right, daytime, daytime, daytime. Here we go. Back to day. Take away some game time. Still dark. Three, 91. There we go. Now we got some light. Okay, so there's the problem with this entrance right here. It's not color mixed. See, the rocks behind it are mixed colors. So as I go from one area to another, the colors get a little bit more like the new area. Oh, there's a problem with that. Right, so that's going to be in area creation where it creates like a stone entrance to, I think it's stairs, create stairs tile. Yeah, here we go. Color rock. But no, we don't want to do that. We want to do, wait, color. We don't even want to color the door light south either. Yeah, so by default, this should be white. And then, really, the only thing that needs to be colored like rocks is this one. So, color equals this, get color mix. Color type is K color rock, given this X and Y position of this current entity, and also its position in re regards to other areas. And then, so Mountain Secret, that's just a black thing. That doesn't matter if it's colored. This already has its own color, and that doesn't need to be colored either. So that should work. What's up, PMC? Sam's number one fan. Just realizing your extensive contributions to Coco City X. Thanks, man. I'm glad you realize. Is there an example of your entity foo in action? I mean, no, there's no actual code that I've written that shared entity foo in action. Just a entity foo does have its own test application though, that does, I guess that's the, tiny bit of action. Songbringer is the only thing I've written with entity foo, and I'm never going to release any open source code for that, except for entity foo and Valtry, which I've already released, and Rapid Game, which I've also already released. So good question though. Vegas, aren't you worried if this game goes big, AAA studios will want to buy it for sequels? No, I'm not worried about that at all because I would not sell it. This is an intellectual property. I'm developing this characters, this world, this whole thing is my intellectual creation. And no, I'll probably never ever sell this, unless Disney offered me $5 billion. Lol, I'm joking. I'm joking. No one would ever pay me that much money for this game. Yeah, there we go. Okay, so now the color is mixed. See, we have this rock right here is very, very nicely mixed into that color of that. Sweet. We should make sure that the other kinds of rocks are also working well. Like put it back to zero. No code for compiling random ARM opcodes? What? Random ARM opcodes? What do you mean by that? Like for ARM, like Android and all that? Rocket Bunny, why do I not use C#? Because it's slow and it's not cross-platform. Except for if you're using Unity, then I guess it's cross-platform. Whoops. Yeah, C++ is way faster and way more cross-platform friendly or portable. The other big problem, you know, I mean, it's not just that C# is not portable amongst the common platforms. It's that C# is not even portable amongst, like, consoles. If you want to go put your game on PlayStation, it's a hell, dude. It's like a nightmare to try and, if you wrote your game in C#, look at how Axiom Verge was written in C#, and he had tons of problems getting it on PlayStation. And then, to this day, he's still trying to get it released on PlayStation Vita. Rocks in the next Star Wars. What if EA wanted to publish it, and that means they have the rights to the game? No, I will never do that. I've already been approached by a couple publishers. What's the game? Devolver. Devolver approached me and said, "Hey, we're looking at your game. Would you consider us taking over the marketing of it?" I'm like, "No, sorry." You know, I did actually talk to them, and I was like, "Okay, let's explore this a little bit. Let's see what this is like." But no, it wasn't a good deal. You know, I'm not going to do that. I want to do this game on my own. I really want to do everything about this game on my own and see how, you know, how well I can do. If anything, I would consider a porting company, you know, like a company that would put it on other consoles and things like that. But other than that, you know, I'm never going to just sell the actual marketing rights to this game or the intellectual property at all, ever. Okay, so that color mixing was looking great. Let's check one more. Let's check it in level one. Oh, an inline assembler. Oh, okay. What for? You want to go for speed or something? All right, yeah, so the colors look okay here, too. Nice. That works all right. How about Monogame, Akira, Ray? Same thing. Monogame is C#, and that's what Axiom Verge was written in, Monogame. And like I said, he had big problems trying to put it on PlayStation, especially PlayStation Vita. You can look at his devlogs about it. No, what did he actually do, Boogie? He used this port or whatever that PlayStation started writing. They started writing some kind of like plugin / porty thing that would take your mono game or your C# code and run it on the PlayStation. The problem that he still is facing today is that they didn't get it to work for PlayStation Vita yet. So he's waiting on them to create this thing so that he can get his game on PlayStation Vita. So no, he didn't write it all in C++ or rewrite it in C++ or anything like that. Yeah, they are great. Yeah, PMC, they're a great publisher, but I don't want a publisher. And besides, their deal wasn't that great. You port this original Game Boy anytime? Nice. All right. Teleport Cube, this is an important thing to decide. But let's do this. More contrast on the senescals versus the green areas. Hey, what's up, Pedro? All right, let's put the player at a position where they've got some tentacles. There's some, let's see. Zero, tentacle, tentacle, tentacle. There we go. 10-0-0. Would I consider them for a sequel? Like I said, I would consider any deal. I mean, I would look at the deal. I would give it its I would give it whatever kind of merits it can, but probably not gonna take it. Probably not gonna take a publisher. Like I said, I want to do this one, probably this whole series just on my own. Oh wow, look at that. These guys are looking okay now. I don't know what it is. What on my On this other computer, these green guys were looking way. I couldn't see them at all. Let's see if there's more light. It's like earlier in the day, like 1979. Please welcome our newest followers, Arctic Planet. What's up, Arctic Planet? Songbringer 2 confirmed. Yeah, I guess you can. It's hard to. I guess it's. Let's take a screenshot here. Here we go. We were just talking about this contrast, right? These guys are. There's not enough contrast. But let's confirm that. Is there enough contrast? If I take this whole thing and I desaturate it completely, can we tell that those are okay? Yeah, see, it's kind of hard to tell. Look at these guys. You can't really tell if they're like an enemy versus the ground. So let's make them a little brighter. So foes, sentinel. This is a really, really easy enemy to draw. And fun too. I give you $1 bazillion. Any plans on how it would be different from Songbringer 1? I'm not at that point yet, but yes, I do have some ideas. I'm thinking that Songbringer 2 might be completely procedurally generated, even the art. It would be difficult to do, but I have some ideas on how that could be done. Maybe not the characters, but like the entire world could be totally procedurally generated. Walk cycle? Oh, you're trying to do a walk cycle for the first time. Oh, right. Yeah, it's hard the first Akira Ray, that's hard the first time you do it, but it'll get so much easier. Walk cycle's not that hard. Keep it to really short. Like do only like 4 frames at first and get those few 4 frames working. And then you can expand it later and maybe do 8 frames or 6 or whatever or more. Yeah, Starbound procedurally generates monsters, right? Pedro say make it a 3D Songbringer. I would consider a 3D Songbringer if it was a fixed perspective. The only thing I don't like about today's 3D games is when the cameras are get too wild. You know, I like it when I like a fixed 3D game, kind of like I don't know, you know, like Dota, for example, is always the same perspective. Okay, so let's brighten this guy up just a little. Maybe 10%? 15. Let's do 15. I never thought the number 8 could be that scary, right? Because eight frames is actually really hard to do a walk cycle for, especially when you have never done one. But when you keep it to like 4, it's pretty easy. Even 2, you could just do a 2-frame walk cycle, and that is way easier. Where did I put this guy? I think he's in foes. Centicle? No, it's not in here in common. Yeah, it's supposed to be foes. Overwrite. All right, there. It's a little bit brighter now. No Man's Sky, right? No Man's Sky is completely. They did really well on their procedural generation. This is when it attacks. This is funny. This is the funniest attack, right? That's all it is. A single frame. Brightness. Oh, this single frame, you gotta manually export these. Centicle attack sheets, foes. Think it might be Centicle attack 0. Yeah, 0. Replace that one. We're almost done with this. You got a watchtower? Scottish Pizza, how are you doing all your models? They're looking awesome, man. That's cool. Pixel art walking, right? Yeah. Oh, is this the one? This might be the one that I looked at when I first did my first walk cycle too. It is. Oh, nice. Nice link, Jules. This is totally what I learned from to do a walk cycle. Yeah. That's a great tutorial right there. All right, last one, a little more brightness here. Oh, whoops. Looks like I did. Oh, okay, that's fine. All right, let's export that. And this first one here, I think I messed up. Yeah, this whole thing needs this brightness contrast thing. There we go. Unity, oh sweet, asset store, right on. Oh, he said he was having trouble with the stream a second ago. Maybe it was maybe nice. You like American football? Right on. Seahawks. I prefer American football. Course, because I'm an American. America. Okay, so they're a little bit brighter, and they're actually I can see pretty obviously that they're brighter. But let's do the same test. Let's take out all the saturation from this screenshot. Yeah, that's better. Check it out. You can kind of see that it's clear that entity is distinct from the background. And if we go to the original screenshot, you can tell. See these original guys? You can hardly see. I mean, it's close. You can kind of see, but not really. So that's good. It's good enough. Let's check that one in and close this. Save the Centicle. Alright. Another one done. More contrast on the Centicles. And here's a good place to check in. You're a Saints fan? Nice. Mathia Mo Slund. Your first game? Good for you, man. It's a soundboard. You hate the 49ers? Right? What do you think of the Raiders? Okay, this was sweet. That was like four things. Nice. Hate the Ravens though. Okay, I don't know where to put this teleport cube just yet. Actually, yeah, if it's in the store, okay, let's first of all, let's make it so if it is in the store that it has a price, you know, shouldn't be free. So let's go back to that store at 201, I think. And then in gear component, it's got the price of the teleport cube. There it is. Yeah, so if you were to buy this, let's make it 70. So there, can't just get this thing for free. There we go. Okay, so if I didn't, and do I have that already? I already have this. Why is this even buyable? Should not be purchasable. I just spent 70 on something that I already had. Okay, let's fix that. You shouldn't be able to buy an item that you already have. Except for bombs and cactuses. So that would be an area when it creates items. Oh, we already have this. Has. All right, let's figure out what's going on here. $1,000,000. Small loan. Just a small loan. Totally small loan. Nowhere near the cost of a house in California. All right, so it's going to loop over the current area's items and then create them as like purchasable items. And it should get to the point where it says, all right, I already have this item. And then it shouldn't create it. Oh, I think there's probably something in there that's like if it's purchasable. Yeah. Has purchasable single item, multiple items, has, where's this purchasable? Oh, you know what? I don't even need to check this. I think it's right here. Just right? You can't go back and get the red cup that you forgot without working for it, right? Yeah, so I'm gonna change the order of a few little things there at the beginning, but in general it's gonna work like that. You get, so basically you're gonna have to go through level one first, and then you can acquire the teleport cube. And then you can go back to Songbringer, and that's when you get the cup for the first time. And so the cup will actually allow you to access the second dungeon, which is this, which will be the psychedelic dungeon, which I finally get to that. There, purchasable and not has, and so if this item is K item bomb, or item equals K item cactus, we could always purchase more of these. Same thing with life. There. Get the cup for the first time so you can get it again. Not really. Rocket Bunny, you're back, man. What's happened? So you can have infinite bombs? No, it's up to your amount of containers. So Vegas, so you have a certain number of containers which you can hold up to a maximum amount of bombs, just like Metroid and your missiles. Same kind of thing. So you have a certain number of containers that each one you get like f you can hold four bombs per container. Damn it, I'm supposed to already have that. Right, what happened? What happened? Oh, you're programming. All right. Cool, man. How's it going? What you doing? Yeah, what's up, Elite SCV? I've been very well. How about you? Right. So the task, the goal here is to make it so you cannot pick up or you cannot buy an item you already have. So we already have the teleport. Current item is there's a lot of variables. Cactus. All right, cool. We're going to go to the next one. Bomb container. Next one. Teleport. So we should have this already. Has should be true. Great. We already have it. Purchasable true. Great. It didn't negate the has. Purchasable, so it gets this item sprite frame name. It's got a profile. So if it's purchasable and we don't have it. Oh. I see what's going on. It needs to check if it's purchasable. Right. So if we already have this purchasable item, if has and purchasable, continue. Get rid of this loop. Don't create the entity. You're doing good. Right on. Glad I have some vacation. Yes. Implementing a linked list. Cool. Learn how to use pointers. Good for you, man. Yes. Oh, it's so awesome, dude. What a cool task, dude. Yeah. Oh, man. I'm excited for you. Hey, now we cannot purchase the item we already have. And if we didn't have the teleport cube, where's that? Teleport cube. Why am I, oh, there, it's the first one. Working on the colliders, cool. Sweet. Yeah, nice. Oh, Sam's number one fan. That's a good point. It probably should be an allowed. That's yeah. That was pretty janky the way I just coded it right there. Good point. Yeah. Let's do that. So gear component. Let's make it no longer janky. Janky code, bad. So we got flags, right? Equippable, craftable, passive. Trigger. So what would the word be for if you can have more than one? Okay, many. You can have many, sure. Okay, many. Or is multiple stackable? Stackable kind of implies that it would go with another item. Stockable? Stockable, maybe. Now, do you know how to make the magician's robe look like it's made out of cloth? Yeah. You mean in your drawing you just showed a little bit ago? Add a little bit of texture. So just take your drawing you just did. Right, like if you had just the gray color, right? So if you had like this gray color, right? You just take it, make it a little bit different, get a very slightly different color. So change your brightness slightly, maybe like a little bit darker. And I'm talking really slight, really, really slight. And then also change your hue maybe a tiny bit, or your saturated just so slightly, like 1% maybe. And then do a single pixels like that. And do some textures like that. See, that was even a little bit too dark. So, and then play around with a few different kind of color textures like that, and that'll give you the feeling that it's cloth. The other thing you could do is you apply a layer on top. So you could go look for a cloth texture online, right? Just go cloth texture or whatever, and barely apply a layer, right? Like take this image or whatever, and like barely apply, like 1 or 2% of that applied on top of your and size it, shrink it, and you know, there you go. Lots of colorful words. Elite SCV, sweet man. Cool, thanks, man. That's awesome. Thanks for doing order goes towards development. You're paying for Songbringer to become a reality, and your name will be in the credits. Well, Jules, same thing, man. Same thing. What's a trigger item? A trigger item is something that just, it's actually an old concept. I'll probably delete that. I probably don't even need that anymore. But it's an item that just does something. So like, for example, it would trigger something else. Like when you got this one item that would open up a teleport thing to get another character or see another NPC or something like that. Yeah, oh, sorry, is the audio really, like, really messed up now? Like, my voice, even? Hello, hello? I don't know what's up, but today's been audio problems day. It does this every once in a while. Is it my voice, or is it the game? It's better now? Oh, okay. Sorry about that, guys. Plus one by a desktop, yes. So you can burn the laptop. Thanks. So how you want to make your a robed wizard guy look like that? Here's my recommendation. Take that exact drawing right there. Scale it down to pixel art where you're trying to draw it and see what it looks like at pixel art and then play with those pixels until you kind of have developed your own style, but that's sort of similar to what you want. I was cyborg for a minute, huh? All right. So K-Mini is equipable is... Can have multiple. Stockable. Stockable. Whatever. Stockable works. It's a good word. Thanks, guys. All right, so gear component. This is going to have a new function called isStockable. There it is. Stockable item. That doesn't really matter if you have a quantity. All right, so get that compiling in the background because that'll take a minute. And back into gearcomponent.cpp. A couple of these items are stockable, like life. Stockable means you can have multiple. Diamond, no, not necessarily. That you can never well, I guess you could be stock. Yeah. Diamond itself is stockable. Teleport, no. Sword, cactus, yes. Oops, that was the wrong one. Right, cactus, stockable, right. Cup, helmet, boots, glove, fire, lice, no, 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 no. Bomb, yes. All right, firebomb, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, that's the only one. None of these are stockable. None of these are stockable. Cool. Okay, so now to implement that function, is stockable item. Oh, see you, Pedro. Sorry, man. Have a good night. I know. Where's Marza? He's missing out on some BC Warrior power. There. Now we've got is stockable item, and we can take away this janky code that was written here in area.cpp. All right. We should be able to get the player's hero here. Call that hero.count item. So, int hero, get player id there. So that's simpler code there. And then this has is if we have the item hero dot, oh, this is hero.gear.count item. And if it's stuck, if it's wait, purchasable. Oh no, yeah, this is correct as it is. We just want to go if we. Yeah, this is all pretty much simpler now. We go if this is a purchasable item. And it's not stockable. And we have it already. There. Oh, you see, right? Yeah, save it. Back it up, man. Back it up too. Yeah, Rocket Bunny, totally, man. That's one of the things that I talked to the dudes at the that threw that event last time, and I said, man, you guys really need to make this live streamed. He's like, no doubt. So for the next one they're doing here in San Francisco, they're gonna definitely stream it. But yeah, I should have at least done a Periscope. All right, so if we already have the teleport. Thanks, Sam's number one fan. Thanks for suggesting this. Making my code less janky, because you write janky code, and then at first it works, and then all of a sudden it breaks later, and then you gotta go fix a bug. So it's always good to write solid code the first time. So there. We have this is a non-stockable purchasable item that we already have. And it's not allowing me to go purchase it again. And if I do not have it, I should be able to purchase it. Don't need this breakpoint anymore. Yeah, thanks. Yes. Anyfu lesson one. There we go. We've got the teleport cube. Let's make sure that we when we walk out of this room too, and we walk back in, we can't buy it again. Yeah, that's cool. But that's weird. Place this item in a really funky place. Why is that? Oh. Because of the number of items. Right? Yeah, fix a bug, get a new bug. But this one's at least fixable so fast. Okay, so we need to remove the item from the list before we actually even do this. So, auto items equals area items, and I'll search for area items. We just change that to items. That's all. And then we're gonna remove any purchasable items that we already have. Whoa, this is like, should be up here. Do I have Songbringer backed up at all? Of course. Oh my God, yes. So much so. I have an online Git private. I have an online private Git repo. And I also have a, you know, a nice backup disk. And hell, I learned my lesson a long time ago. You got to back up twice. And make sure your backup's online, because you never know where you're going to lose your laptop or something. You don't want to lose a couple years worth of work just because of something stupid like that. So we can go it's erase. Jeez, so many names for delete. Erase elements, that's the thing. Erase elements from item, function, given, const, item type, type ref item. We gonna capture purchasable. We do the same thing as has here. So, also we should capture hero. Let's do it like this. If area heroes. Oh no, it's game scene. Game scene heroes dot size is greater than 0, and game scene heroes 0 gear count item greater than 0. And this is not a stockable item, then return true. You back up your game on Dropbox, so it works. Yeah, Boygas, that's why I have my own backup drive as well. Yeah. Yeah, but I recommend everybody, you always should have at least a drive as well, an external drive you back up to as well. You can hide that somewhere, you know. RuneClip, how do you handle rendering? Just iterate through a list of entities that needs to be rendered. CocoaStudioX has its own rendering pipeline, and you set up sprites, and they kind of work that way, yeah. Basically, every single tick of the game's animate loop, it goes and touches every single entity and visits it. It's called visit. So it visits every sprite to make sure it's in the right position and all that. And then it passes it off to the rendering pipeline, which tries to optimize it and put together sprites into one batch call so OpenGL is as efficient as possible. Carbon copy cloner, right? I haven't tried that one. You can also use rsync. I mean, rsync is a great backup. If you know how to use rsync, you're good to go. All right, erase element. This should be right. So if it's gonna erase an element from the items array if it's purchasable, and we have a hero, and the hero has that item, and it's not a stockable item, right? Okay, so same thing. Snow. You really? I love snow. I wish we got more snow in California. You get plenty of snow in Northern California. All right. Let's buy that. We'll go upstairs. Sorry if it's loud. Sound issues. Oh, same issue? What? What? Cool pizza. Yeah, Rooney Clip. No, not necessarily. Yeah, it kind of works that way. Yes, you would kind of like go, okay, here's all the entities. In fact, it kind of does that work that way. Right, and I have a render component. Right, so a render component has a sprite. This is a subclass from just the regular sprite class of Cocos 2DX. And so this sprite here contains what is necessary to draw that sprite, right? But there's no need for me to go and like loop over all these things or anything, because what all I do is when a sprite is created, is added to the scene. This is Cocos 2DX land, all right? This is very specific to Cocos 2DX. In Cocos 2DX, everything is a node and everything can be a parent or a child, right? So you start off with a main node is like your scene or your layer or whatever. And then underneath your scene and your layer, you have sprites, tons of sprites and other stuff. And things can be children of that and so on. And so once you've added your sprite to the scene, Cocos 2DX's renderer handles everything else. So really the only thing my render component does is create the sprite and add it as a child to the scene, and then it's all good from there. There's nothing else that it has to really do except for maybe run its animations or set a label or change its color or whatever. Does that help? Does that help you understand? 'Cause yeah, I know what you mean. When you're at that point of writing a game, it really does help to understand that. Yeah, right. Forecast. Right, what's. I think it removed the item, but it didn't like change the position. So the row size. Where does it get row size? Oh, duh, right here. No wonder. All right, the first thing this needs to do. Let's get the number of items. And if it's purchasable, there. And then this items. Oh. Okay. That should work. Famous last words. Yeah, I understand. I was just wondering if there's an automatic way to call all entities render method without having to add the entity to a list or something and then iterate through it. Yeah, well that's kind of how entity foo works. Check it out. If I go to let me give you an example of of looping over all render components. Prepare flux. It's a method called prepare flux. There you go. This is how it loops over all render components. Right? It gets a list of all render components. So this is using entity foo's get all method. So it gets every single ID for all the render components. It loops over all those, and then it gets the actual render component by calling entity get, and then it checks to see if it's empty. And then if not, it does some stuff with it. So that's one example how you would loop over every kind of component, or every component with a given, you know, given kind of component. 3 a.m., 2 a.m., you guys are up late. Elias, if you do have a good resource for learning Cocos 2DX, yeah, thanks. Thanks, Boogie. That's not the most up-to-date tutorial on Cocos 2DX. I wrote that a long time ago. But it's still English. What I mean by that is there's a lot of Cocos 2DX tutorials that are not English out there. Nice. Okay, I guess this is something to do with the actual position, num rows or something like that. So we already have this entity, we get in this room and it's misaligned. Let's make sure it is misaligned. SFML, I've heard it's good. Yeah, okay. There's misaligned. We got that. This one guy's over there on the left looking weird. So why the hell? Actually, it should do this before we even call erase elements. By creating an entity, you add it to a list automatically, right? So just whenever you create an entity, it gets added to the render list. No, that's not true. When you create an entity, it creates an entity ID. And that's a very important distinction to make versus a component. Entities are simply just an integer. That's all they are. When you create an entity, it has no components to start with. For it to get added to the list of render components, you would need to add a render component to that entity. So the first thing you do is you call entity create. That gives you a new entity, but it's blank. There's nothing contained inside of it. And then you go and add a render component to it, and now all of a sudden you've added it to the list of render components, right? And that list is associated with that entity ID. Does that make sense? All right, so items starts off with three items. Oh my God, let's just skip over this. All right, so now items is two. Great, we removed that one item. Now why is it having problems with its row size and all that? Row size should be two, good. Num rows should be one. Step six. Oh, cool, another idea for the teleport group. You find the corpse of one of your friends. Oh, Jules, that's a cool idea. Oh, that's a really cool idea, Jules. I like that, because there's already bikes. Yeah, there's already other bikes on the world, so might as well have a teleport cube near one of them. Hmm. I like that a lot. I think I might do that. So for your engine, you just add the entities to a scene's entity list. Then I iterate through the entity list and check if the entities implement renderable or updatable. Okay, yeah. That's one way to do it, totally. Yeah. Right? Just two different ways of thinking about the same kind of thing. It's good. It's so good that you're using an entity component system. Oh man, I'm so excited for you. Is this have you written games before without entity component systems? Doesn't matter if it's contained. Okay, so this first entity. What's count? Count should be zero. It is. Row should be zero. Yeah. Row size. Two, right? Here's the thing, x width times a half plus count mod row size, that should be zero, minus row size shifted down one, which would be one. This should be negative one times step. Width is 21. Oh, it's the step. Oh, maybe it's not the step. What the heck? You've never finished a game? Oh, that's all right. What's up, Caviar? Sorry, I know that's not how I pronounce your name. I'd like to know how to pronounce your name, though. Just has a back structure. All right. Nice, cool. Hi, Jules. See right, so it places this entity at x 4, which is step minus 1. Yeah. Oh, you know what? That just might need to be times a half. So if we run it to the next loop, this should be count one. Yeah, it's going to take the width times a half plus one mod two is going to be one minus one times step is zero. Yeah, that's the problem. This math is wrong. So this X is going to be right in the middle of the screen. It should be 10. All right. Now I understand why that is not centered. So for anybody just joining the stream, oh, the audio again? Damn. Really? Hello, hello, hello. Do I sound like a robot still? Cav, all right, Cav. Cava, all right. What's up, Kalisu? What's up, Felix? Yeah, sorry about the audio today, guys. I don't know how to fix it without restarting the stream, and then I would cancel the current video being rendered or whatever. So, yeah, I've already tried OBS. XSplit is only for Windows. OBS has real bad problems with audio on Mac. It's way out of sync, and I could never get it in sync. So I finally gave up on OBS and switched to Game Show, which has most of the time been way better. So this should be simple, right? It's the width times a half plus. Think this a float. This should be times a half. Let's see if that works. At what stage is this game? It's about 60% finished or so. It's at the alpha stage right now. The beta should be in a couple months. Okay. So this X turned out to be what? 4. Still wrong. Next one turned out to be 10. Same problem. This needs to be. Oh, if the row size is even, it needs to add half a step. Oh. See if that helped. Oh, he's becoming too nice. Okay, let's see if this works because I really want to get on to doing some other stuff. X, what do we got this time? 7, yay! And 13. Awesome. Run the game again. I might need to close the stream down here a second. Not feeling so well. Run, run, run. Run thyself, game. Yes, all right. That's all I wanted. We got some centered items. Beautiful. Come in, go back. Same thing. And if we had not the teleport cube, we should be able to buy it, walk out of this place, go back in, and oh, damn it. There's 3 items, and it still offset them. Wait, no, it didn't offset them. What the hell? What am I hoping to achieve by the end of this stream? Nothing. Nothing, man. I try not to have too many expectations because I never ever seem to quite get all of what's done, what I want to get done in a certain stream. And that's the same thing for his whole day, you know? Jim sounds like R2-D2. Great, I'm glad he does. Because I was totally hoping he would. Oh, yeah, that's it. All right, screw it. I'm done with that. I don't want to work on that anymore. In fact, I think I'm done with the stream too. I gotta get going. It's dinner time here. But let me show you guys what's been changed lately. This is the game finally has a day-night cycle. So you can see the player's shadow getting longer. Let's go to nighttime. I'll show you guys. Oh, in fact, I'll show you the super cool nighttime. There, I'll show you the quick nighttime thing. Failsman, what's up? Yeah, see you guys. Hope you have a good night. I'm just gonna show the game one last time with the new day night cycle. So here's the really quick night cycle going by really fast. The shadows moving across, going from east to west now. Yeah, so that's it for today's stream. I just got a bunch of different polishing elements done today and probably keep on polishing tonight. So I hope you guys have a great night and you slept in? Sweet. 12-hour debug hotkey. Alright, so yeah, we'll check you guys next time. I'll be back tomorrow, same time. And not the next day. So tomorrow's the only other day I'm streaming this week. We got a lot of plans to travel and have some fun for New Year's this year. So I'll be back tomorrow. See you guys.